It's my privilege now to introduce Mik Kersten, and let me read his bio. He is CEO of Tasktop Technologies, where he sets strategic direction for the company and drives many of Tasktop's key partnerships and customer accounts. He's very active in maintaining the company culture and value. And the thing that I like about Mik is, you know, this guy's a real programmer. He created the Eclipse Milan open source project while working on his PhD in computer science. He was a research scientist at Xerox PARC, implemented the first aspect-oriented programming tools for something called AspectJ. Been working on Eclipse since 2002. Three-time elected board member of the Eclipse Board of Directors, serves on the Eclipse Architecture Council. This guy is more than just talk, he's action. And he's spoken at our conferences before, but not as a keynote, so we welcome Mik Kersten.
Thank you so much, Lee. So yeah, my name is Mik Kersten, and as Lee mentioned, I used to spend almost all my time, coding. So I started working on an open source project when I was at Xerox PARC, and I'll actually show you a little bit about that. These are the people. This is a visualization of the people that I worked with, and you'll see later in the talk what this means and how this is laid out. But these are some of the people I collaborate with in open source. So I checked on Olo the other day. It's about a million lines of code collaborating with a lot of different people on these projects. And what I noticed is that we were able to very quickly deliver a lot of interesting software. And we had I was working closely with a team of about, it evolved over time. The bigger the people are there, the more closely I worked with them. And this visualization spans from about, 2006 to 2010 or so. So this is kind of the team. You'll see some people on the periphery. Those are contributors in open source. Some periods, they grew and grew. So as we made, this is actually a visualization of the Eclipse Milan project. I think of all the people there, I only met about two of them face-to-face. And only two of them were organizationally related to me. So I was working most of this, at this point in the project, most of it was happening when I was doing my PhD at the University of British Columbia and trying to look at how we could connect developers to the software lifecycle. So Milan itself was a project and a tool for connecting the development environment to these lifecycle tools that we're forming to help developers work on distributed teams. Because again, we didn't meet face-to-face. IRC channels or Skype were just not enough for us to collaborate on what we were working on, because we were still, even though it was open source software, even though it was kind of happening in the wild in the jungle, we still had some kind of requirements that we were working to. We were still writing tests. We were trying to figure out what features would be most valuable. And we created this infrastructure for ourselves of an issue tracker, of source code management tools, and it became very effective. And the Milan tool itself was about connecting a broader community of contributors into that infrastructure. So because we made these tools for ourselves, we became the Eclipse project that had the most contributions from outside of the Eclipse committer circles itself. So a seventh of the project was created by non-committers. And committers on an open source project are the people who have rights to modify the code. People are giving their patches, similar to how you can contribute content to Wikipedia, that gets reviewed. People were submitting their contributions on this. So the scale of these projects grew. One moment, it looks like the display is getting a little cut off. Let me try to fix that, because you won't see things on other slides. So the scale of these projects grew while we were at Eclipse. And the collaboration tools themselves, there we go. The collaboration tools themselves grew as well. So today, that was a little while back, today, we've now got over 60 million lines of code in the Git repository for Eclipse. Back then it was CVS, went to Subversion, and sort of followed the trend of open source code management systems. The Bugzilla repository, it now has 400,000 things in it. And they're called Bugzilla reports. They're basically the same things as you have in an issue tracker like Jira, or in a requirements management tool, or in a help desk tool. But in Eclipse, what was interesting about it is all one tool. And that visualization that you saw at the start that basically drew the people I worked with most closely closer to me, those were the conversation threads from Bugzilla. So the more I interacted with somebody, or the more anyone interacted with anyone else there, the closer they were on that graph. It formed this interesting social graph over the history of the project. And the scale just became very large. And then the wiki is another one of these pieces. And the Eclipse infrastructure is all open source tools. So it uses the open source media wiki, and there are 40,000 pages. And I was very impressed with the way that Eclipse scaled out to support this sort of size of software delivery. And the tools that we were building at TaskUp at the time, because after doing Mylan, we created the TaskUp Technologies, the company that creates the commercial version of Mylan, and extended Mylan from open source repositories to commercial systems, such as HP Quality Center. That was the first tool, and this was a surprise to me, that was the first tool that we had massive interest for outside of open source. Is developers who were using this Mylan IDE plugin really want to talk to Quality Center, and I had no idea why. I didn't, at that time, really know or care what Quality Center was. So we started talking to customers, because we were sort of growing our first set of customers. We were this lean startup. The company was founded right after I finished my PhD thesis around Mylan, demonstrating that developers could be much more productive if they had some kind of social artifact to anchor their collaboration to. That's what we proved out with Mylan. I'll talk a little bit about that later. But we started talking to customers, and we were looking at their Agile deployments. We were doing our own style of Agile at Eclipse. And it was sort of beyond Agile, because we had actually tools for consuming user input. We had tools for consuming requirements, all funneling into this Bugzilla repository. But when I started talking to customers, they saw how I did things, and they would show me how they did things. And I was getting these diagrams either on my whiteboard being sent to me from these very large organizations who were trying to emulate the very lean lifecycle loop that you've got on an open source project, where the delivery, the pace of delivery is very fast, and the pace of impact is very fast. Someone contributed something to Mylan on a Friday. If we approved the patch, it'd be going out to 50,000 developers the following Monday, because obviously we had continuous delivery in place, and there was an easy way to consume and update all the Eclipse clients and so on. And I just became fascinated with the fact how difficult this was for these organizations to do. They were trying to bring in parts of this open source tool chain into their organizations, and they still are. A lot of your companies are probably doing that. You're deploying Git. You're looking at an issue tracker that has a similar interaction model to the open source Bugzilla. One of the close ones is Jira. There are other open source tools like Track and Mantis. But they're not plugging in properly into this larger scale lifecycle. And so there's just been something wrong. That diagram that you see right there, that's a Fortune 50 company deploying Agile, as committed to Agile deployment as any organization can be. And the little dots there, they're actually little red M's. Every one of those dots is some kind of manual process. And I noticed that the difference with what we had on Eclipse was that every single step of the lifecycle, all collaboration was captured and automated. We never had to have a status meeting in delivering all of that software. And there's a lot of software that we delivered. There got to be over 100 different extensions by many large organizations on top of that software. And we were able to effectively work on it because there was no manual step. Everything was captured, everything was done with continuous delivery, and everything was planned in this nice agile way. These organizations I started talking to turned out had many more tool chains. And this is a presentation. I was just earlier this week, I was at the IBM Innovate conference, where this was, in this case, Ericsson, showed their tool stack. And this is a public presentation from Ericsson. They use these, every one of the open source tools you can imagine. They have every single issue tracker. They also have about another 40 different tools. And the different lines of business have selected their own agile planning tool. They've selected different source code management tools. They have contractors, and they outsource some of their delivery. And they're just nowhere near the sort of lean flow, the ability to go from a business idea to a deployed customer and get the feedback, or learn that what you're doing makes no sense and fail fast, because their tool chain has become so disconnected. And there's no, and this is not unique to these organizations at all. This has been true, what we've noticed, to any companies who've got more than 500 developers. It's been very difficult to deploy these agile techniques. It's been very difficult because you have to incorporate not just developers, and I think as an industry. We've now been, you know, with books like, you know, Developers Being the New Kingmakers by Stephen O'Grady, we've put a lot of emphasis on how important developers are. And they're absolutely at the core of the lifecycle. And I'd like to think that developers are great as well. But if you're churning out software really fast and you're not making it part of an end-to-end lifecycle, it might not matter, right? If it's not delivering business value, or if it's not taking feedback from a customer that then gets back in and helps you decide where to invest in your software portfolio. Again, for Agile and the large, there's just been something very broken. Agile that's driven into teams by evangelists, by people who want to transform your team or a small set of teams, has been working great, and we've got a tool chain for that. Agile that's driven by the executive office, there's been something wrong with, where you've not, it's transforming a part of the tool chain, but not transforming the end-to-end lifecycle. So one thing I think that we've not looked at enough in all of this is just that you've got different types of stakeholders in the lifecycle. Again, developers are great, and developers like to make tools for themselves and like to think of themselves, and I did too, as, you know, sort of like Neo working through the Matrix, or you know, you're creating so much so quickly, and as long as you've got everything that you need in front of you. And that's why integrated development environments are some of the most interesting and fascinating tools to me that we have, because they put all the information that you need to get work done to create software at your fingertips. And that's basically where I spent most of my career, is making sure developers have all of the information they need, including the conversations that determine what a requirement is, what a user story is, what, you know, how many votes are on this feature request, and we're there. We've made tools for that work for developers. We've made the lifecycle tools, and developers actually drove those changes themselves over the course of the last decade. Because the previous generation of tools, and really over this last decade, what's happened is we've gone away from management-heavy tools, things like ClearQuest and ClearCase and the Rational Unified Process, to developer-centric tools. But it was interesting for me to learn that there are, when you get out of open source, when you get into these organizations, it actually takes more than developers to build software. So you have designers, and developers sometimes may not think much of designers, but designers might not think much of developers either. And both are required if you're going to have a really slick mobile app that really pleases your customers. So you've also, you know, designers like to, and designers think of themselves as great, and they need their own set of tools. Like, they need Balsamiq, and they somehow need those tools, and they might even need Photoshop, and they somehow need those tools to connect up to the developer tools. You've got managers in the loop, and managers just like to think that they can throw more developers onto a problem, and to their disappointment, there's something different about software than about building phones, where it's not quite the Foxconn dynamic, where you can just throw more developers on it and you get more. And developers tend to think that they actually don't need that level of management. And so those tools, the amazing thing about the popularity of a tool like Jira is it's stripped out that management functionality, the 40 required fields that you need to fill out when you submit it, when you create a new defect, are gone. And we've just gone to this very interesting, I think, mismatch now, because we've matured in the way that we deliver these tools specific to stakeholders, but we've not connected them. And then once you've got that 500 developers, and actually, I should mention, the organizations I work more closely with, they don't have 500 developers. They have 10, 20, 30,000 developers. And when they're trying to deploy Agile, deploy open source, they're getting into this very big mess, because we've create tools specific to stakeholders, but these stakeholders, not only do they have cultural differences, and that diversity actually you get a lot of benefit from, because if you had developers designing all your user interfaces, you might end up with something that looks like Git, and you might have already done that. So there's a lot of benefit, but we somehow have to connect these different cadences that these organizations work at. If we're gonna elevate just out of Agile, into this more lean lifecycle, this end-to-end lifecycle. Again, Agile's focused on the problem of developers, and if we're gonna apply the principles of lean manufacturing, we have to step outside of that. We have to include these other stakeholders. And it's one of the reasons that I come to this conference, because it's not all developers. We've actually got, there are a lot of people here with a testing background, a lot of people here with a business analysis background as well. So I think while we're over-popularizing the role of developers as an industry, we're actually seeing problems that result from that. And so I'm gonna talk about some of that in this talk. So again, looking back at the last 10 years and looking in those diagrams, when you actually look into those diagrams, there's sort of the life cycle architecture both the tool chains, the investment budgets, and sort of the organizational boundaries look like this. You've got these stovepipes in the organization of, again, developers and developer-centric tools. So those have changed tremendously over the last 10 years. Open source and open source collaboration models have completely transformed that. It's just fundamentally interesting and bizarre that a tool made by Linus Torvalds in his spare time is in the process of displacing commercial SCM tools that have had orders of magnitude more investment, just like Subversion displaced tools before that. Agile project management itself has now, also over this course of the last 10 years, where developers were sort of rebelling, and project managers, against the inefficiencies of these very top-down waterfall management-driven processes, Agile has completely transformed project management tools. So specialized tools have come up, like Rally, like version 1, like ThoughtWorks, tools like Rational Team Concert, and they've transformed the way project management is done. It's much more iterative. And bizarrely, those two sets of tools tend to be disconnected, right? Jira probably has the most market share in development, but Jira is, if you've got hundreds of teams, let's say you've got an application portfolio of 500, it's pretty hard to plan across that when you end up with 30 Jira servers. Rally is a tool that's got a very great model for larger scale Agile, but it's not meant for developers. And developers, it's very different than the sort of lightweight tool that fits nicely into the IDE, that's optimized around the developer workflow. So we have these disconnects, and the disconnects end up in these just endless status update meetings that we do much too regularly, not just for the purpose of Scrum, but for the purpose of getting on the same page or sending emails and reports and so on. And it gets worse once you kind of go out, look out onto business analysis and testing. Again, the cadences get different, and the tools are very different. Quality center and testing still has, you know, somewhere between 40 and 60% of the market. Nothing has displaced it yet. And it's, testers tend to live in that world. They've been living in it for 10, 15 years. The mental models are the same, and it's very effective for a certain type of QA. Maybe not if you're an ISV and shipping a social tool, or maybe not if you were an open source project like ours and actually depend on crowdsourced testing. The way that you know, some of the web applications that we use, some of the social media applications that we use depend on. But if you've got a more traditional application, and most of the applications that we build are not new social networks, you need that QA loop in the process. And there's this struggle of figuring out, do you embed all your testers in the Agile teams? What are they doing at the start of an application when there's nothing to test? There's just some fundamentally weird mismatch. Operations is the same thing. Operations wants to run at a different cadence than development. Development, you know, you want to be deploying to your lab environment, you know, ideally hourly, that's what we do, but there's a pretty big cost to deploying fully to production. You're an ISV, you can do continuous delivery, that's great. Most of your applications in your organizations are not like that. They actually have to have some other staging. There's more process involved to deploying them. So this silo focus, and it's been a silo focus both by vendors, by these sort of different cultural shifts, again, with development, it's been open, developers, it's been open source, with project management, it's been Agile, and everything around that. The silo focus has also driven the vendors as well. Vendors have specialized in each part, in those parts of the life cycle. And we've ended up with just completely disconnected tool silos. And that's what you saw on the previous slide, that between those tool silos, we've got manual processes, and this highly effective way of collaborating and connecting the conversation of software delivery that we felt on the open source projects I worked on is just not there, where you're able to consume feedback, turn that into a plan immediately, ship that, prove it out, and get to this, you know, what's now being popularized by the Lean Startup book, by Eric Ries's book, as this build, measure, learn loop. Because in the end, if you're trying to deliver value, you have to, you build something, you have to measure its effectiveness. The effectiveness might be ranking in an app store, the effectiveness might be votes for a new feature, new ideas from your customers, and then learn and feed that back in. And we're just not there yet. And these problems are not only being exacerbated by how much change there's been in the way that we develop software, but by these other factors as well. So the business now wants shorter iterations. And this Lean Startup stuff, and these lean principles and Agile are, they've just come of age. Executives, the CIO just wants to put this in place. So we know we need to do this. We also tend to know it's a good idea. The way that we create software, So I already mentioned the developer-centric point on the tools. The technology is changing. We're not assembling software as much, or we're increasingly assembling software from web and REST services, so from multiple sources of information, rather than just packaging up JAR files, packaging up other assemblies of software, then being able to test those. So our applications are just becoming, they're becoming very heterogeneous. And you know, in testing, things like service virtualization are now required to even have any sense for whether this application is going to work once it's deployed. And then this other interesting thing that I'll get to at the end of the talk is that as a result of these APIs changing and as are changing to building more systems of engagement, so more things like mobile clients that get their information not from one database that you've got running as part of the application, but from a number of services, like a social service, a service that gives you, customer data, CRM data, and so on, we're creating these software supply chains, and we're having a lot of trouble doing that, and if we don't start thinking about this lean lifecycle, I just don't think we're gonna get very far in supporting this. And as an example, I'll refer to open source. In the way most organizations now consume open source, more than half of developers in some surveys are shown to actually contribute something back to open source because of how much they're consuming it. But in terms of consuming open source as a lifecycle, organizations tend to have no idea how to do it. So they basically grab the source code, they think of it as consuming physical bits. They don't connect to the lifecycle of an open source project. They actually just grab the source code. So if you're building on some Apache component, some library, and all of a sudden, in that Apache Jira, there's 10 defects that appear, that there's this major security flaw, chances are that your organization will have no idea until it actually gets exposed on your end through your QA. So we've got this, I think that the key thing to keep in mind here is that the lifecycle is not only disconnected within the organization, within those organization boundaries between business analysts and developers and testers and project managers, but it's actually disconnected in the way that we're composing our software from other sources, basically from other organizations. Open source projects are just another organization in your software supply chain. So we already, even if you're not worrying about the API economy yet and how you test those services in your application, if you're doing any open source consumption, you already have to be thinking that way, is that that basically the technical debt going into your application is not just your own source code. What you have to test is not just what was produced by your organization, but this very sophisticated stack. And thinking of that statically, not as an evolving lifecycle, introduces all sorts of problems. So going back to sort of how we started approaching this, I'll just give you a quick glimpse of what I did when I realized that this problem, I was working on development tools about 10 years ago and focusing on all my effort on IDEs, and I decided that this problem of stakeholders being disconnected, in particular developers, because my world back then was all about just about developers, disconnected from the lifecycle was a bigger problem than improvements in new frameworks, new tools, new web toolkits for getting work done. So I went and did my PhD thesis on that particular problem, saying, do we need some kind of new abstraction for connecting development to the lifecycle? And in open source, this was already forming because the popularity of issue trackers, it was this new thing. Previously, again, things were just, the conversations were not captured around software delivery, but 10 years ago, that changed. So when we did the Aspect J project at Xerox Spark, this program called Jitterbug from MIT, I think, at that time, became very popular, and then Bugzilla came. And then Track and Mantis and Jira all had that same model, this very lightweight way of capturing conversation around software. Not top-down management around software delivery, but capturing developer conversation, conversation with customers, conversations with the people building on the software, and so on. So I looked at that, and I thought to myself, basically, everything that we've done around trying to connect stakeholders in our organizations, again, just think about developers, was all around sort of packaging files and shipping around information and files. And at Xerox PARC, I got the chance to talk to the people who worked out that concept, that this desktop metaphor was this useful thing, because we knew about files and folders and those sorts of things. So let's chunk the information that we collaborate on into files. And we've been doing that. And we've got, that's evolved into now these even more collaborative file systems, like wikis, like MediaWiki, like Confluence, and so on. But that's all we had. That's all development environments. That's the only way that we connected developers to each other at that time. And the other thing that Xerox PARC came up with was email. right? It was just messages. And those two things, turns out, are just not rich enough to connect this conversation between stakeholders. So looking at a system, a developer, for example, as systems grew more complex, had, you know, if a bug came in, you had to browse through so much source code to figure out what it was. The time to analyze the defect took so much that I figured there was just something fundamentally wrong. Because when the developer created that source code, they knew what they were working on. They knew the requirement that they were working on that came from some business analyst, or that came from some planning session or design session. So I thought, if we could bring in the way that we work, the way that basically we create this information, the way that we look at the application and the value that we deliver into the developer's experience, something interesting could happen. So what I did as an experiment for my thesis is make this task abstraction. And initially, it just supported Bugzilla and then Jira. And we kind of threw it out into the open, into the Eclipse IDE. And we said, OK, there's this fundamental problem of complexity. And if we could somehow show developers only what's related to this task and allow them to communicate on tasks, maybe something interesting would happen. And we allowed them to indicate what tasks they were working on. And we brought all of the notifications, basically made the IDE be the switch client, so all of their collaboration would happen around the task. And we showed them only the code related to the task when they were working. And then this interesting thing happened. And Mylan kind of, this became Mylan. This became the notion of task context. And Mylan kind of caught fire and is just now a core part of the Eclipse IDE because it added this one new abstraction of task, the task focus interface, and the task management layer into the IDE. And it allowed developers to communicate purely through those artifacts in a way that was connected to their workflow. So every single comment that they made was also connected to their source code changes. And then, so just as an example, in the Mylan code base itself, every single defect, every single defect is connected to source code changes. So if you get a new stack trace from a tester or from a customer, you can always trace back to the exact comment that was made for the exact feature that was being implemented, the exact requirement. There's full traceability of the conversation that you're having between the task level, so defects, requirements, user stories, so on, and the source code level, which became this interesting thing. And what's amazing is now if you're trying to deploy Agile, what happens when you don't have any of that? I'll look at that in a moment. So we got this notion of social task into the IDE, context to link it all up, and we went from there. To do that, we created this new model. And the model is just basically, this task model has a notion of a workflow, an activity stream. And that was something, again, that was missing previously. And then this context. And this context idea turned out to be pretty powerful. So workflow is just the type of task that you're working on. And the interesting thing about it is that it could handle both a requirement for a quality center, once we got that interest, and an agile process. So something iterative where things fit into a sprint. The activity, you had this conversation stream. You had this other activity stream, like change sets being committed, builds being done. And then you had this context, which is everything that was changed when the task was being worked on. So rather than thinking about the system source code first, we changed that, and we made the IDE be task first. And actually, if going back, literally what we did in this experiment is we added this new pane on the right side of the IDE. So on the left, there's always the, you know, basically like a Windows Explorer or a Mac file browser. You can navigate your source code. That gets filtered down to only what's relevant. On the right side, you've got your whole task management inbox. You've got this one task list that's bringing tasks from the open source project you're using, from any, you know, from Quality Center, from wherever it is. So we made that work. We proved that out, demonstrated that developers were much more productive, were more than twice as productive when they worked in this way, because they worked on only, they only saw the code they needed to see. And then we got a lot of interest from organizations outside of developers. And what we were hearing when we were deploying the commercial version of Mylan to these companies, to, you know, these financial services institutions that they like, is that they wanted tasks to connect other stakeholders. And they did these bizarre things, like deploying, and this is where we learned in this lean startup validating learning sort of way, that they were actually deploying our desktop client to connect tasks from Quality Center to an agile project management tools that developers never touched. Because we made this one model that could federate those things. And we thought that was kind of interesting. Because we learned from that it wasn't just developers who needed their window on this, but that all of the collaboration boundaries in the organization and the software delivery lifecycle were on these task-like objects. The way that developers and testers need to communicate was just on defects. Right? Developers, testers could do their tests, when they found a defect, that defect needed to show up in a developer tool. And the way that these organizations were working is that they would often be manually entered. I actually have met someone whose job, full-time, hopefully not completely full-time, I hope he did something else, but was manually entering quality standard defects into Jira. Requirements, the same thing. The requirements are needed to be seen by both a business analyst and the tester. And that means if you've got two different tools, they need to exist in both tools. A tester can't properly create a test plan when they don't see the requirement. And as we shift out of Microsoft Word for managing requirements, it's more structured systems, which is another key thing if we're ever going to get better at building software. Those span the collaboration. Same with incidents. A help desk or an operational team needs to be able to create incidents that go into QA or go into dev. So we said, OK, maybe we can extend this abstraction to other systems. And we basically looked at the stack as these different layers. You had the issue tracker layer. You then had this agile planning layer. And you had this enterprise application lifecycle management layer. And again, just as there was different focus from the different vendors on different parts of the silo, there's also different focus on different scopes. So you had the enterprise ALM vendors like Microsoft, like IBM, like CA and HP, and they were creating very different tools than the very sort of more socially oriented, developer-centric tools being made by the issue tracker. And again, the agile tool somewhere in the middle. But none of these tools were talking. And the organizations today, they tend to be completely separated. And there is not a proper feedback loop. We've got agile within the agile team. Developers are connected to it. We do not have this lean picture, this lean view of the life cycle. And for the organizations that have taken the additional step, they've done these very bizarre and interesting things that are not working either that we've seen a lot of. So they've connected up their databases, which is a really interesting symptom. So they've basically got either some tool or some internal tools team that has made sure that defects out of Jira can be sucked into Quality Center, you know, once every 24 hours. And there's still absolutely no sort of, that helps, by the way, right? Because then the defects are in both places. But there's no way to capture that conversation. The value of this new generation of issue trackers, the value of what we've learned from open source and from bringing that open source of development into the organization is that the conversation's what's important. The actual requirements, you know, if it was just about sending every stakeholder the requirement specification like it was in the old days when we were doing waterfall, there wouldn't be a problem. But we're learning as we go. And lean principles are about this notion of some kind of validated learning and build, measure, learn loop. So if you don't capture the conversation, you're only importing from a database once every 24 hours, you can't have that. You fall back into email, or you fall back into status meetings where there's so much friction that the iterations get too slow. After that, tools layered on these different API layers so to address some of this. And so almost every single, and this was partly done to get, you know, basically to get things like rich clients created. So we were at TaskStop worked with a lot of vendors to extend their web service API so they could surface their tool in the Eclipse and Visual Studio IDEs. And that helped, and then some integrations were formed. But again, it was completely ad hoc. There's been no process model that spans tools, right? When you look back, these different layers of tools, each of them has this process model, knows what's open and closes, and when something needs review. But we don't have a process model today that spans the life cycle, and that spans stakeholders, and that spans that diversity, right? We talk a lot about process models and about cultural changes at the Agile conference, but it tends to be all around the needs of project managers, not developers. Everyone's got their different view. We now are at the stage where we need a model that spans the different life cycle stages. And it's not enough to say when you're deploying Agile that everyone should switch to two-week iterations, because if you say that to a company with 10,000 developers and 5,000 testers, and then a huge operational team, it just won't work. So this has become bad enough now. We've also been taking it for granted, but the interesting thing is that things like the deployment of open source tools, the need for faster cycles now being something that CIO is interested in, mean that for organizations deploying application lifecycle management tools, in other words, sort of larger scale tools for issue tracking, for Agile, and so on, the integration process has now become the biggest problem. And so that same problem that I got obsessed with in connecting the developer has now become this problem of connecting multiple stakeholders. As you know, Agile has come of age, we have to move forward. And the costs of this problem are fascinating. when you look at large scale software delivery. Again, you're a small ISV, you're a small company, it's fine. You're just gonna have your Jira and your Zendesk and your Git or Subversion servers, and it all works. You've got 50 or 100, 150 developers, it's okay. If you scale up, it just stops working because, again, you need to have that diversity. You need to have people like functional architects. You need to have testers, and you need them talking faster than once every 6 weeks. And this beautiful aircraft, I read this, I was just totally fascinated by this article that came out. It was in 2008 when we started thinking through some of these problems. And I read that, you know, the problem with this additional delay, and these delays on aircraft are horrendously expensive. So this additional delay, the problem wasn't that the brakes don't work, which made me feel better because I knew I'd be ending up on that aircraft soon. But it was, or hopefully soon, it was the traceability of the software that caused a multiple month or delay of the 787 in 2008. And this, you know, this was just this funnily bizarre statement to hear, where, you know, traceability, we knew on the Mylan open source project it was so important because we were so resource constrained, we knew that we'd never have a hope of fixing a defect if we had to look for the whole source code base, always be searching for the, you know, for the stack trace elements and so on. So we had this kind of lean process built in. I thought, oh, you know, this actually turns out to be a problem at scale. What happened was Boeing subcontracts the brake software, or at that time did, to General Electric, which subcontracts to a French company. And the French company implemented the brake software for the 787, and all tests passed. You know, all the functional verification, everything was done. The brake software worked, it was certified. Oh, sorry, the brake software worked, but right before it was certified, one of the certification processes was to make sure that Boeing had, there had to be traceability from every line of code to the requirement for that line of code. And the reason Boeing needs that, like we need it on the Mylan open source project, is not so much that they're completely resource constrained like we were, but they have to maintain the code in this plane for 35 years while it's up, while it's in production, and then 35 more years while it's in service. So you've got 70 years of maintenance, and if something happens, changes around the brake software, the maintenance costs are just way too high when the output of one of the stakeholders, the people who did the brake requirements, when that changes, you have to change something about the brake software, and now the cost of change just gets tremendously high. So they scrapped the entire brake software, and they rebuilt it from scratch, adding the traceability. And then took a huge cost in the delay. The battery problem is a little bit similar. It was a hardware problem, but it was four supplier levels deep. So that information around the product lifecycle management, not the software aspect, but the product lifecycle management also did not percolate up the supply chain, the problems that could have emerged with the battery at that time, the fact that it didn't properly fit into the system. So this collaboration problem between stakeholders turns out to be extremely expensive, even though we don't always realize it when we're building the software. And the way that I think we need to apply lean thinking to this problem is to look at what the problem is. So what are there in lean, one of the main things that we need to do is to reduce the batch sizes, right? In lean production, and the story is, I think I have time to tell this quick story, but we tend to lean towards making big batch sizes and passing things on. For some reason, the way that we think, we like to think in terms of separating work and creating big batch sizes. So if you're planning your next, you're sending out your Christmas cards, you, as engineers and as technical people at least, we tend to think that, okay, the best way to approach that problem is to have me write out, you know, print out the Christmas cards and add, you know, then for my wife to put all the, print out all the addresses and stick them on envelopes, and then for me to shove the letters into envelopes and so on. So we divide the process, and we sort of optimize around dividing the labor. And if you run this experiment of whether that's faster or to have me do every step of it. So I print out the Christmas card, I stuff in the envelope, and I put on the address. The way that's faster is the latter. It's faster not to divide it up, not to batch it up, because we always underestimate the cost of sorting and of organizing and of handing off. So it's actually faster just de facto. And there's this other issue, which is that if you do that and you find an error somewhere in the process, so I put my zip code or postal code wrong on one of the stickers, you have to restart again. You have your batches blow up basically. You have to go back to the start. You have to take, you know, you have to go reprint all the envelopes. So it's the whole principle around being lean is that you want to minimize batch sizes of whatever you're trying to make lean. And so the question that I was struggling with at this time is, what are the batch sizes that we want to minimize in software delivery? We know we want fast iterations and to be cranking code out faster, but in the end-to-end process where it's not about code, what are the batch sizes? And looking at the Boeing problem, if you look at what they did, they basically created a bunch of requirements. And this is sort of, you know, a timeline of the project. It's a timeline of many projects and many waterfall projects, but not just waterfall projects. Projects that are Scrum, water Scrumfall as well. Then developers took those requirements and they implemented them. And then there was a bunch of testing that was done. And the height of those triangles is, think of it as the number of tasks that are being done. So requirements are these tasks that get passed on for developers. They represent units of work for developers. They have definitions, which are their context, but they represent all these units of work. So you batch up the requirements, pass on development, pass on to testing. And then in the case of Boeing, you've got this last operational step, which has to do with verification for the plane. Right? You end up spending $20 billion to do the certification for the plane. And if you don't find a problem until you're in that last step, it's insanely expensive to then go back and fix it, because you end up delaying the entire delivery. So the way I think about applying lean thinking to the software lifecycle is to minimize those task batch sizes. And they can't just be minimized in development, because if they're just minimized in development, it doesn't matter if you're doing agile and very iterative software development if you don't find out something that blows up a requirement early on. If you're building a mobile app and the web service, you know, basically, you've got some great requirements of how it's going to be a super slick user interface, and then you don't find out from your designers that they, you know, the designers don't find out from the developers that they actually don't have the right web toolkit, you know, to make those animation flows work. Or you find out in operations that there's no way, given your current infrastructure, your selection of a platform as a service solution or infrastructure as a service solution, is just not going to support the scale that you were dreaming up on the business side. And you have to go revisit and actually re-architect the application. Those are very expensive decisions because they're all about very slow failure. The key thing with applying lean is that you have to fail fast. And we have to not only fail fast in the development, in the agile stage, but you have to fail fast from end to end, right from requirements and business analysis, right to operations. And again, the issue is that we just do not have a tool set that can manage batch sizes right now across these different stages, because the tool sets that we use have become extremely specialized. And the only things that we have for connecting across things are really lame 20-year-old technologies called email and spreadsheets. So we somehow have to move to a different kind of infrastructure in order to support this lean lifecycle. Again, in order to elevate our thinking outside of Agile being just project management development and embedding a few QA people on each Scrum team or a QA person on each Scrum team into thinking about this end-to-end process. So I think the interesting thing is whenever you get these fundamental problems, you need some kind of new infrastructure. You know, we ended up with this new infrastructure for these social task systems that became interesting, and now we need new data models and new infrastructure for capturing this lean end-to-end lifecycle and for making, basically for connecting this conversation around software delivery. So what we've been working on is this, something that we're calling software lifecycle integration. And it's this effort, both within the company, with our open source ecosystem, our customers, of creating a new infrastructure that does not connect all of us delivering software in this point-to-point fashion, or in this unautomated fashion of doing status updates, but where we actually have an infrastructure component that layers over top of all those pieces. And we've come up with a data model. And this is, by the way, this is all a work in progress right now. So there's a white paper on this. It's the white paper is version 0.5. But this is something that we're iterating on right now, and we've put out there, and we're collecting ideas around, and we're collaborating around. Basically, coming up, and I know this is a little hard to see, but I'll read through it quickly, coming up with a common model for the software lifecycle that spans the different stakeholders and roles. Again, it's not centric to development, but it has to be able to express the needs, the concerns of developments and the tool chains of developers. So this is actually a slightly newer version because we've been working with organizations over the past couple of months. We've made some updates this week where we learned, for example, how there's this fascinating project. I was speaking with people at a company called organization called PaaS, which approach this, it's from Japan, funded by the government and other bodies. They have to solve this integration problem for their software supply chains. And the way that it works for these software supply chains and companies like Fujitsu and NTT and Hitachi is different than here because of the nature of basically software projects there and the lifetime employment. They have, at those companies currently, software supply chains 100 levels deep. And the only, so 100 companies are making the government software systems or other software, you know, basically the software system delivered by those companies. It's this huge software supply chain, and there's no tool set, there's no model that's able to represent this. So again, it's just this complete mess of spreadsheets where nothing is linked other than by, you know, manually entered cells. And what we were working through is, again, this common model that we could create for the software lifecycle. But I think the key thing is every time we've tried to make one of those models, it's really been around managerial control. And the whole, I think everything that we've learned over the last decade around what makes stakeholders productive is not more managerial control, but it's more autonomy, right? The reason these lightweight issue trackers are so popular with developers is they give them control. So the conversations of the individual contributors, and then, you know, in Peter Drucker's terms, knowledge workers know more about their particular function in the organization than anyone else. I mean, that the definition of knowledge worker is someone who knows more about their job than anyone else in the organization. And every one of us here is a knowledge worker, so we need a model that gives us control over the life cycle, allows us to participate in that conversation, because that's where you learn. It's basically grabbing the collective knowledge of all the stakeholders and putting them into this model that where the information can flow across the supply chain, across the value stream, is how we need to approach this, not by figuring out exactly how we can plan and trace over and control sprints and control delivery. So at the top of this model, what we have is this lifecycle artifact. And then under that, we have two, and this is the split, and this is a split that we learned from the Mylan project, from that experiment, is that there's two aspects in the model that are key. One is this lifecycle asset, the things that we already know how to ship around and share. So the lifecycle assets are basically, they're things that you can save as a file. Dropbox can deal with them. They can be pages in a wiki and so on. And they're versioned. They can be attached to an email. And so we're already very mature in terms of the support that we have for working with those kinds of assets. They can be compiled and turned into executables and then pushed over some connection to run as applications. And the thing that we now need to span software delivery is an abstraction for this other asset. And this is what we're calling the social task. And just the same way that the assets that represent value are composed into products, social tasks represent work and are composed into projects and teams. And we've decomposed these assets into, we've got things like plan items. So those can be epics, they can be requirements, they can be user stories. And they basically requirements management artifacts. So we've got work items, so those are issues and enhancements, incidents that come up from a help desk system that represents something that a customer needs. And we're creating, again, this is not done, so don't try to implement this yet, but we're creating this one model that'll span those various tools and allow us to basically, you know, have one way of collaborating across these things. Because the key thing here is we can't end up in this world for software delivery where we end up with social networks right now, where, you know, part of your world is in Google+, another part is in Facebook, and those worlds are not connected. You can't connect those two activity streams. And that's basically where we've been heading with software delivery. And that just won't work, because we have to have these two, you know, these different stakeholders collaborate, whether it's because they're doing different styles of delivery. Part of them are doing .NET development and using Microsoft Team Foundation Server, and part of them are doing Java delivery and using Jira. So we've got this one abstraction, and we link the whole notion of context that Mylan proved out is how we link these two kinds of assets. So we've got context linking social tasks to assets. This might be the documentation that you produce. This might be the code that you produce or the executables that you deploy. And there's this clean split allows us to create this infrastructure to focus only on the green stuff, focus only on wiring up the collaborative and social artifacts that represent what we work and how we plan the work that we do while we use existing infrastructure for the management of all those assets and files and those sorts of things, because we already have that. That's all already there. You can already share files very easily across the organization. You can already share source code and executables easily across various tool chains. So note now also requirements. We've actually split things up in this model. So the requirement definition is an asset. right? The balsamic diagram, the wireframes and mockups, they're on the asset side, while the requirements, the thing that you collaborate on, the conversation around the requirement is a social task. So the way we've been approaching this now is basically to connect up these various tools for each of the stakeholders in this lifecycle bus. We think that this is the piece of infrastructure that's missing and that's needed to layer over and to basically allow us to go from faster iterations and more lean delivery in one part of the lifecycle to basically a connected lifecycle where information flows. I think one key aspect of this is, again, that sort of tends to be ignored in the way that it's being deployed in organizations today, is that there's one notion of iteration, and it's just not like that. Different tasks, different lifecycle stages have different notions of iterations. So the things that are common on a social task are the activity stream. Everything that participates in lifecycle has to have an activity stream. We had very long discussions with HP about the fact that in HP Quality Center and ALM, you know, versions 9, 10, and 11, activity feeds are just, you know, the activity feed is just this one field with comments in it that's just formatted text. Whereas with the newer systems, what we learned from open source, the activity feeds, the comments are very much a first-class thing. And so, you know, tools like HP's new tool, HP Agile Manager, which layers on over top of Quality Center, has this first-class notion of an activity feed. All of the tools now have support for things like these common time boxes and configurable workflows. Because every one of those stages has a different notion. They all have a shared activity stream, but they have a slightly different cadence. And that's the key thing. In creating this unified process model, this is kind of a static view on it. What you have to do is you have to connect the different cadences. You have to know in a help desk, there's basically as soon as a ticket transitions one of its workflows to needs to be reviewed by dev, that needs to trigger an automatic flow of that information, everything that's been learned about that defect, into the development system so it can be scheduled onto a sprint when it's going to be visited next. And developers don't want the same cadence as the help desk. The help desk has an even faster cadence and is even more interrupt-driven than a two-week sprint. Right? Developer does not want to look at that defect unless it's meant to blow up the sprint or blow up some of what they're doing until they're planning the next sprint. So on top of this process model, the thing that's key to layer is this workflow model that matches each of the cadences of the organization. And the great thing is once you've got this kind of abstraction and you've got this lifecycle infrastructure, you can do that. You can actually author over this common model workflows across those tools. And you can connect that to your existing infrastructure as well. So I'll show you an example right now of how we've done that actually internally in our organization and in the way that we work with open source and the way that we work at TaskTop. I'll just show you this kind of visualization toy that demonstrates what happens when you wire up everything, all the stakeholders, with the social notion of tasks. Let's see. Oh, I think I'm only seeing part of the screen again. Is it possible to do whatever you did before? Okay, are you able to toggle it? I can try with, oh great, thank you. So this is just an internal, this is a Butterflies application that was created by one of our developers, and it's just a toy visualization, but what it does is it's like we have this process model deployed internally at TaskTop. Every single bit of work that gets done, from requirement to testing to development, is captured on some social task. And as you can imagine, just as they don't in your organizations, those don't live on one system. But this graph is sort of similar. It's a little bit packed because it's got quite a few collaborators in our organization. It's going to take time to lay itself out. But what it's doing is it's looking at the different people who are working. Nicole Bryan's actually a project manager. So she's touching a lot. She's feeding a lot of requirements. She's talking to developers a lot. She's kind of a nexus. Miles Parker is closely involved in our open source project. I can break down some of what we're seeing over here. But the really neat thing about this is that across our entire organization, we have this, basically, this. Even though we're spanning tools, and we're actually including here some of our contractors that we're working with, we're also using different systems, right? Just like you might use a different issue tracker or a different quality center repository if you're outsourcing part of your development or your testing. We've got this one connected view on our entire lifecycle, including every single open source project dependency that we have. Every open source project dependency that we have, we're connected to the issue tracker of that open source tool. We know if there's a new security defect that comes in. The purple stuff is actually open source, coming from open source. The way this graph is laid out, yeah, it's on this resolution, it's a little hard to see, so I'm gonna lay it out a little bit differently over here. I'll pick a different subset of it. So these are all our open source contributions. And this is just over a 1 month time frame. Basically, the bigger a person is, the more they're talking to other people, and the closer they are together, the more comments they made on a task together to each other. And we did this reorg recently. We actually looked at this information for the reorg, because the way that people work together tends to be the way that they self-organize. And one of the principles of Agile is allowing people to self-organize. So all of this information that we see here, these are some of our open source contributors of that next month, I can now show this juxtaposed against our requirements in product management. So now there's a lot more people. The purple stuff's open source, is all the open source tasks. The blue stuff is all the non-development tasks. So everything around product management, and again, over here you can see that this person, Nicole, was involved in a whole lot of them. If I hover over that, I'm sure some of that's private information, so I shouldn't do that too long, but you can see everything that she's worked on, she's interacted with people on. And you can see the developers that she's talking to. If it was bigger, it wouldn't be such a jumble. But what we've got here is the entire social graph structure of our end-to-end lifecycle. And we're able to deliver it in this lean way because everyone is connected, even though they're using different tools. Because we're proving out this software lifecycle integration model within our own stack by creating this bus. And all we're seeing in this visualization is the data that's on that lifecycle bus that spans all those sorts of tools. So again, you kind of see the open source people working together, and you see the sorts of things that people are working on. And we can keep adding to this. So now we can add our development team to this, and then it gets insanely messy. But if you stretch this out, you'll actually see that the way that people talk to each other is the way that they organize into teams. So there's no notion of team in this graph. Right? It's literally just showing comments, and the closer people are, the more they talk. But you let this play out over the course of a month, you'll see that it organizes into teams, and you see, for example, which developers are talking to which open source contributors. Which of our business analysts are talking to which project managers on the development side. And the whole thing is connected end to end, which means that information flows. And we're able to actually have this, not only this agile delivery, but this lean lifecycle as a result of this. And here you're actually seeing in the purple on the right are open source committers, the green is all our developers, and the blue is all the product and project management. And again, different tool chains. Because the developers in the organization use an issue tracker, and the product managers insisted on using a different Agile tool. All right. So I think what we get out of this connected lifecycle is this ability for every person in the lifecycle to have this degree of autonomy they didn't before. Because again, they've got the tools that they need, and the conversation, their contributions to the process, flow up into the lifecycle. We've got transparency, which is interesting, right? The sort of problem that Boeing had doesn't exist right now because the linking that you need, the traceability that you need, is already there in the modern developer tools. The problem is it's disconnected from the requirements management tool. But once you connect these things up into a common model and allow information to flow, you've actually got that full traceability in your application. You've got the ability to do a report like that and see how your team should self-organize so you don't get stuck in this mode that a lot of organizations do, which is the way that you deliver your software is just based on Conway's law. The way that the teams were organized and those decisions that were made actually determines what software you're able to deliver. In open source, it's extremely different. Teams self-organize because people have, there's this level of transparency where I can contribute to another project. And I'm able to much more easily align my interest and my intrinsic motivation with what I'm doing. If I'm building on some kind of framework that's in the company, I might be making a lot of contributions to that, and I actually might be best suited to working on that framework. And the self-organizations, once you've got that level of transparency where people can collaborate across projects, you end up with this much easier ability to self-organize and can break through that sort of Conway's law. And again, the key thing is that you've got this across different stakeholders, that testers are just a big part of the conversation, as are business analysts. Because even though we're stuck in our own tools and we don't want to log into four different applications over the course of a day, you can collaborate across these tool boundaries in a way that, again, in the same way that you could imagine collaborating across Google Plus and Facebook, once you've got this lifecycle bus deployed, this notion, and a common model that you've created, that again, we're still iterating on, you can actually support that conversation having diversity in it. So in terms of the, I'll just quickly go over some of the patterns that we've seen in terms of how we deploy this. So this is, the way that I think this is happening right now is that we've got, there's already some tools change that support this new way of thinking about the life cycle, this lean life cycle. So we've got some proof points, and I'll show you some of the ones. Another interesting story I heard, there was an organization who was firing, because they bought into this new, and this is a very large organization, they bought into this new school way of delivering software, and they actually had deployed the Jira tool. And it was working so well for developers, they said, okay, we have to get testers working in this way. And so they, policy they made is that testers had to use Jira. And the testers were slow to change, because they'd been using Quality Center for so long, and HPALM more recently. And so they started firing testers who wouldn't make the change, thinking that they were too slow to change, and were not adapting to the organization. And then it was 3 months in, after deciding that they should take these more drastic measures, they realized that was not the right thing to do, because too many of the good testers were disappearing. And they realized they actually needed the best of both worlds, right? The cadence and user experience that Quality Center evolved over so long in terms of supporting the needs of testers, and what the Jira tool learned from its very large open source deployments at supporting this agile workflow with developers. Next one is requirements traceability. Again, the same thing. You need requirements to span both those systems. Requirements layer over both dev and QA. If you're building mobile applications, you need to be designing those applications outside of a dev tool, because some of those new requirement tools, like the one written on your badges, are very good at what they do. Blueprint is a very modern requirements management tool and has a feature set that other tools, the dev tools, don't have. So, but what that tool is not any good, or the tool is not designed for meeting the needs of developers or testers. So that state needs to basically span dev and QA. We've got to give stakeholders the best of breed tools, but to do that, we need a model that's able to span those tools. And then the most fascinating one that we're going to get, I think, that we're going to see is the ability to have those artifacts, those common shared artifacts that we need to collaborate on, link up the software supply chain. So you've got, let's say, the extreme case of this is when you've got an organization who is doing none of its own software delivery. Right? It's basically just doing the business analysis and creating requirements and seeing whether the software is working. So it needs to see the output of QA. You still are doing all of your requirements management, all of your business analysis within your firewall, even though your software is being produced outside. And this is going to keep happening more and more as we look at the statistics of Eclipse. So much more of Eclipse is now being downloaded from Asia than from America, that it's basically becoming clear that much of our software delivery is coming from outside. So we need this lifecycle bus. It needs to be a vendor-neutral thing, and the key thing is it needs to be collaborative. We cannot make the mistake of the rational unified process again, where it's a managerial, sort of top-down control mechanism. It needs to be a mechanism that supports autonomy of each of the stakeholders. Because as we're already learning, they're choosing their own tool sets anyway. It needs to be scalable, so it needs to support basically not scale to one set of stakeholders, but all of them, and eventually scale to the supply chain. It needs to be interoperable, so we're working on standards such as the Open Services for Lifecycle Collaboration standard that's now on Oasis, that was announced last week. It needs to support these open standards that are forming for connecting these stakeholders. And the really interesting thing about it is that we think it needs to be completely invisible. So nobody wants to log into another system or deal with another web UI as part of their workday. So it needs to support your work and your system of choice, but the ability to collaborate across systems. And this is new, I think, an important new way of thinking about the tools that we use. Previously, we've always thought about just adding more features to each tool. But again, we've got fundamental differences. A developer tool is meant to work at very fast iterations, these two-week iterations, and collaborate around that. A help desk tool is meant to work, you know, basically in real time with a customer. And requirements management, it's just painful if you're iterating too quickly. You don't want to see everything the developer's doing. You want to see what progress they've made to so that you can learn and adjust your requirement. And you might do that on a four-week cycle, as long as you're getting the data so that you're informed that, you know, maybe you might have to revisit one of your requirements and you get to do some additional business analysis. So the whole goal of this infrastructure is also that it's invisible. The way that we see it split up in your organization, again, this is a vision for a future, but I don't think we can wait too long for this future, and we're able to test some of it now, is that there has to be a split between the systems of record for your lifecycle and the systems of engagement. So the system of engagement are, for example, you know, you want reporting and traceability across the lifecycle, so you need that level of visibility and control. We've got agile planning, and that's an example of a tool. Rational Team Concert can be an agile planning tool. But there has to be a split in what those systems see, and this is, I think, next generation systems of engagement will do this. The systems that we have today are pinned to their own system of record. Right? They only see their data. Any tool that you use in the lifecycle right now, it's connected to its server, to that database, or to that hosted repository in the cloud, and that's all it sees. And this needs to be the way forward. Where defects span tools, those special purpose tools. Because an ops tool sees a defect in a different way. It might have like megabytes of attachments of stack traces that you just don't care about as a developer. You only care about the output of that, the analysis of it. And for that, we also need this new protocol layer that's forming. So a new set of open protocols, because the internet protocols that we have enough are not sufficient. So we've worked closely also with the W3C on this notion of linked data that can allow us to link those things. And then this new federation layer, which is going to be this new infrastructure over the next few years that we'll see. And then that will transform our ALM stacks. And that's what we will build. We'll be able to build this lean lifecycle on. So in terms of the way that we see this evolving over time, so just looking at, just taking a quick look at the evolution of lean principles since they started. You know, the part that I've always sort of cared about that's been near dear to me is the how tools can shape and change the behavior of stakeholders and, you know, can completely transform our productivity. There's a reason Git is so popular. It gives developers this new level of control and this new level of linking between the work that they're doing and the code that they're producing and a new way to share it. And it's absolutely been transformational, as have services like GitHub that have embraced this model created by Linus Torvalds. So the cultural aspects that you hear a lot about at the Agile conferences, I think, are really important. But it's the tools that allow us to scale those, right? Training people when you've got 40,000 of them is more difficult than creating a tool chain that encapsulates some of those best practices and encourages some of those behaviors, because in the end, we know what we're doing. We're having this conversation that defines the software that we deliver, that goes between stakeholders and customers and executives. So culturally, you know, what we saw is this evolution in terms of lean thinking, where we went from Taylorism, and it really was about scaling production in the way that Foxconn and other device manufacturing organizations scale it today. You make it algorithmic, so that anyone can be added and trained on producing something, and then you can just add more people. Fordism was this interesting thing, because what it noticed was that creative work doesn't work that well this way. It empowered workers, and then quality management actually discovered that knowledge work and creative work need a whole new level of management. And we went from this ability to do just pure assembly to do some automation with Fordism and factory chains, and then with quality management, we actually had supply chains that involved creative work. Right now, we've defined agile delivery. We've now got lean thinking again, thinking not just agile project management, but a lean lifecycle. We've learned that open source is a key input to that. We've got this notion of social coding, and we can now wire together that with social tasks so that we can hook together all these stakeholders in a lean lifecycle at the different cadences that they work. And then I think the really big thing is to use this infrastructure first to prove it out in our organizations, and then to use it to connect the software supply chain. I think this will absolutely transform and be that 10x multiplier on software delivery. So with that, I'd like to say thank you.